Okay, so we're going to look at building some synoptic links here. So trying to make connections between one topic and another. And that's a really key skill within sociology. So we're going to be looking at synoptic links between changing family structures and trying to tie it in with topics we've previously covered. So what we're going to do in this, we're going to think about influences on changing family structure, how the family structure and design has changed. And we're trying to think about theory and perspectives, childhood, DDOL, demographic trends, and social policy, and how this all ties together, how this could be used within questions. Now, this is the table, the mind map we're going to do. So if you want to pause the video for a second, do a rough drawing of this on some paper, or take a screenshot of what's on the screen right now, and then obviously print that out and work on it. But this is what we're going to work through. And if you want to take some time, have a go at filling this in, and then you can always come back to this video once you've had a chance to have a go. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump straight into thinking about some of the ideas that I've had in relation to this topic. So here we go. So just move on to the answer. So just to think about this topic overall. So first of all, theory and perspectives. Now, as I said, I've pulled some ideas. I've had a think about this. These are the ideas I had. They're not definitive answers. They're not perfect examples. They're not the perfect answer. These are just the ideas that came to mind when I was trying to think about how to draw connections. So there's probably ideas that I've maybe missed. There may be things that you may not feel relate, but obviously, it's down to our own interpretation. And really, when it comes to the exam, the skill is about the justification, the explanation, the analysis. How do you make your point? How do you justify why you think these two ideas are connected? So in terms of theory, how these link to changing family structure. So first of all, with functionalism, I thought about Wilmot and Young, because they highlight the idea of the growth of symmetrical families, the change of families from around the 70s onwards, that we were becoming symmetrical. So that's one suggestion of family change, particularly in the structure. So women taking on paid roles, men taking on more domestic and childcare roles. Their evidence was questioned by Oakley. It's not denying that. And we have obviously been in the postmodern era, we've moved on, but it's a good starting point. I thought this shows a connection to a change in the structure. Parsons and Murdoch, I've only got them here just to highlight again, they were outdated. They're very old-fashioned, very traditional nuclear families. We could talk about how today the structure has changed to the point where they're quite outdated. They're not really applicable or as applicable to a 21st sort of century postmodern society. Feminism. Also, all about female liberation, roles of the family, changing gender roles, and questioning the inequality. And obviously, particularly liberal feminism here, I'm looking at the idea of the suggestions of change related to social policy, which will come up in a bit. New Right, Murray, Dennis, and Erdos, resistance to change. So, again, what we'll see later is a lot of New Right social policy, resistant to diversity, resistant to change in family structures. And again, there's a connection with policy. Social action. I've only got them in because when you've got the discussion of the different types of families, the work of Beckett, different types of marriage, or was it Clark? One of the Beckett or Clark. You've got the recognition of different family types. So particularly one of the things that recognised was the reconstituted families, the surfacing families, where there's obviously issues with previous relationships. So it does recognise change in the structure, particularly towards reconstituted. Personal life is all about family choice, negotiation, the family experience. So again, highlighting that the family structure has changed because we have more freedom to interpret and define the family as we want. And lastly, postmodernism is all about diversity. So big key on changing structures. Now, when it comes to childhood and their influence on family structures, a lot of this is more about how the family structure changing has influenced childhood. But I thought we could obviously look at it the other way around. So one of the things that has changed is children have moved from economic assets to economic burdens. This led to the development of the housewife role, which changed the family structure and introduced the sort of traditional nuclear family that we've seen in the modern era. As society has developed and changed, we've had less children, decline in number of families, children in the family, smaller families. So the structure has become smaller. We can talk about Jenks. So in postmodern society, parenting and parent identity is really important, particularly due to sort of decline in family structures and relationships and other changes. So again, it recognizes there's been a change in people turning towards the family or childhood as a source of identity. And lastly, Mason and Tipper, talking about how biological family ties are less important. The structure of the family has changed because there's more diversity, flexibility, freedom. Children have a bigger role in the family, particularly in defining who is part of the family structure. So again, those families of choice ideas from personal life kind of tipping in here as well. Now, when it comes to domestic division of labor and the power relationships, the main arguments you got, it wasn't so much about the structure of the family. A lot of these arguments are about the roles people are performing within the family. But there's a few on here I wanted to flag up. So obviously, particularly Wilmot and Young, Oakley, Duncan and Marsden, they talk about the structure in a very implicit way. So Wilmot and Young talk about symmetrical families. So we could talk about the idea of, you know, those symmetrical dual earner families, the family changing in that sense that both partners have a role. We could potentially suggest that there's less children because that's when women are returning to work, because there's less children within the family. Oakley talks about the dual burden, women working. So again, it's pulling at straws, but it could suggest that smaller family choices, sorry, family structures, maybe less children or no children, allowing women to do paid work and housework. Duncan and Marsden talk about the triple shift, so the emotion work, the labour of love. So we could even extend that into providing care for older relatives, so maybe the development of beanpole families. Guernsey was lagged adaptation. So as women return to work, men pick up more housework. Again, a bit like Wilmot and Young, we're suggesting that we have these dual earner families that could be linked to less children. Future foundations, very much the same idea. Dunn talks about gender scripts. Now, again, this changes the structure in the sense of families of choice. So who is involved, same-sex relationships, maybe remain childless. So that could be a link to the structure. Fallon Vogler, pooling and co-independence with weeks. Again, it's more about financial, so women returning to work. So we could suggest about the role of children being more or less significant there. In demography, and their change on family structure, I thought about birth rate, fertility rate going down, so less children, smaller family size, maybe less children per generation, so we might see more beanpole families, tall and thin families. The death rate going down, linking to that, so the role of grandparents, more beanpole families. We might also see more extended families as old people get older and care for older relatives becomes important. They might live with families, so we might see more of an extended family living together. Life expectancy going up. I thought about the idea of, you know, that could lead to family change. So longer life expectancy, there's more chance of people marrying, divorcing, separating. It can lead to, you know, reconstituted single parent families, step families. People may be living independently for longer. So again, more lone person households increasing. Migration would see change in the family structure. So, you know, the bit like LITWAC and the modified extended family or LATs. We might see dual heritage families. We also might see, in terms of migration, families coming to the UK often having more children. So having, you know, higher numbers of children, so larger families developing. And lastly, globalization, again, the movement of people sharing different ideas on family structures and creating more choice and diversity. And last but not least, social policy. So social policy, loads of social policy has an impact on the way the family is designed and is structured. Now, the main differences, the main changes we've got, if you think about left and right wing policy, a lot of conservative policies, such, you know, going back to what we said at the very beginning about Murray and Dennis and Erdos, they like traditional family structures. So man, wife, children, biological, married, almost a traditional nuclear family. So some of the policies that have been introduced have encouraged or reproduced that idea. So just with the idea of the Health and Social Care Act, it obviously put the premise on community and family providing social care and less demand on public services. That could create some of those extended families you mentioned. Married couples tax breaks, cuts to legal aid could encourage traditional nuclear families or monogamous nuclear families. And legal aid prevents divorce. So that would obviously reduce the number of single-parent families, reconstituted families. Divorce reform act coming at the very beginning, that would have led to more single-parent families, more reconstituted families, so changing the structure of the family. Equal pay sex discrimination sends women to work. Child support encourages men to provide financial support to the family. That could create single-parent families with a smaller structure, or it encourages empty shell marriages, sort of prevents men from leaving their family, but that would obviously again maintain a nuclear structure. Paternity rights and free childcare places, again changing the family structure, so we might see more in terms of the structure, men taking the main childcare responsibility. I know it's kind of bordering onto role, but again we could talk about the idea of families becoming having less children, particularly the childcare places, so parents can return to work, so smaller families. And lastly, civil partnerships, same-sex relationships, again coming all the way back to personal life and some of these topics about families of choice. So again, some of these ideas are just ideas that popped in my head, sort of very loose ways to connect previous topics. Obviously the whole topic on changing family structures is the one where you're going to get the core of your material, but I thought this was one just to kind of think about how sociology is very synoptic, how it is all tied together. Okay, so just some examples of some questions here just to kind of tie this back together. So I picked some 10 markers at the very top. You can see outline explain two changes in society that have led to changes in family structure. So that could be policy change, it could be migration and demographic change, that could be thinking about some of the gender role change in DDL well, it could even be changes to childhood. Outline explain two changes in society which have contributed to the increase in single person households. So again, that could be social policy, that could be feminism, you could bring in changing attitudes towards children, so people remaining childless or choosing not to have children. So again, lots of, and again, that question particularly, what I think is important to flag up is it's single person households. So this is, obviously we don't want to fall into that trap of talking about single parent families. You look at the question, you start seeing single person, you go straight to family. So again, it's about people living on their own. So education and employment becoming more of a priority, people choosing to delay or not have children, people involved in serial monogamy and having multiple relationships until they settle down, longer life expectancy playing a part in this. The third question, again, there will be an item with this, but I've left the item out just again, more for the topic. So policy affects the family structure. So again, we're thinking about social policy, which you will eventually study, but pulling in how it ties to family structures. You've got question four, the fourth one here. So a 20 marker about the decline of nuclear families as a result of diversity. So it's not explicitly about changing structure, but it's more about changing type. So growth of family diversity. So this would be arguing that we have more family diversity now and we have less of a nuclear family. And it's trying to provide evidence for and against. And then last but not least, the last one here. So again, evaluate the sociological contribution to our understanding of trends in divorce in the United Kingdom since 1970. So general attitude, divorce generally rising. But again, this is because it's, you know, sociological contribution. So you can bring in theoretical perspectives, a bit of feminism potentially, new rights to support this. You can bring in social policy and explain the role of policies in changing society. You can bring in maybe a bit about demography and life expectancy, people living for longer. One of the big things about the aging population we have is that we see remarriage being quite high in older generations. Obviously, part of that could be due to death and partners dying, but we might see people living longer, so there's more chance of people in their lifetime experiencing divorce. You know, 50, 60 years ago when life expectancies were much lower, you were married and you know, you weren't, once you've had children and stuff, there wasn't much time afterwards to sort of think about other options. So it could be some of these ideas to consider. Okay, there we have it. So again, as I said at the very beginning, it's a very brief synoptic overview. It's just trying to pull some strings and tie some ideas together. As I said, I'm not proclaiming these are perfect answers or all the answers or the exact answers. These are just my ideas and just some ways that you could loosely connect what we've previously studied to where we're going to be going next. Okay, and I'll leave it there. So thanks for watching. I hope you found this helpful, and I'll see you again. Have a go at the activity yourself. Right, take care.